Hi guys, so today we are here with a new subject on indirect taxation. Okay, so let me go with my introduction on Customs Act. So Customs Act has not gone for really a big change when it comes to the pre-GST era to post-GST era, but there are few changes in the calculations from pre-GST to post-GST. But as of now, let's worry only about the post-GST era, because we are in post-GST era. Okay, so this Customs Act 1962 was enacted in 1962. Okay, and it extends to whole of India. Okay, so coming to the concept, okay, so what is customs? So customs is nothing but a barrier for the movement of the goods from outside of India to within India, and same way from India to outside. So whatever is coming within India, we call it as import, and whatever we send out of India, so that is, we call it as export. So for exporting the goods, there is one of the important document called Bill of Export. If we are sending by land, okay, there are countries which are sharing the land border with us. For example, China, Bangladesh. So for those countries, we can send the shipments through land also, and they must have bill of export for that, which will be issued from the respective custom station, or there should be a shipping bill. So shipping bill for the sea and air movement. So guys, here I have given you a model shipping bill, how will it look like. Okay, so you can see here, this I have taken from Google, and here you can see that shipping bill, it will exactly be like this for any exporter. So as a CMA, you will be part of any manufacturing company, and if you are part of manufacturing company, you will surely, and if your company is exporting some products outside India, then you must see this document almost daily. So who is the exporter? What is the invoice number? We generate invoice number for the goods. Okay, and who is the consignee? So for the customs out, you will be having an agent. So who is the agent? What is his license number? What is the flight number or vessel number or the vehicle number? And what is the RBI code? What is the export trade control number? And what is the type of shipment? Okay, port of discharge, which port it is. Okay, and this is the detail and description of the goods. What is the quantity? What is the FOB value? FOB value is nothing but the value of products you have manufactured, and the value additions till it reaches the port. So that is, till that, all the costs will be included, and that comes as the FOB value. What is the weight of the shipment? That is important. And so on overall, if you see, it is nothing but the data of the complete shipment or complete parcel. So this is put as a shipping bill, and this is certified by the customs office through the customs house agent. So this is a model shipping bill. Okay, so shipping bill or bill of export is nothing but for, is an important document for exporting. So same way for import, we will have a document which we will see in the subsequent slides. Okay, so here our books are giving some more definitions. Let me just go through some definitions. It may be useful for your objective types question also. So you can see one of the thing called coastal goods. So what is coastal goods? Okay, so certain goods, okay, which are, they are other than imported goods transported in a vessel from one port of India to another. Okay, for example, Chennai port to Mumbai port. So we have a coastal shipping line, okay, and the importance of it has considerably increased in last 4-5 years. Lot of coastal ship movements are going, because for example, from Chennai to Mumbai, We can go by land also. It may be some 1,500 kilometers. Okay, so just think how much the vehicles will be polluting and how much time it takes and how much risks are there comparing the safety and all those stuffs. The moving through the ship in the coastal line will be much cheaper. I think it will be almost 30 to 40% cost saving if you go by the ship route and within the coastal line. Okay, so, and the importance of this is considerably increased in last 5-6 years. If you are following the latest news on this, the importance has considerably increased. Even the automotive companies are shipping their cars through this way. For example, if a car which is manufactured in Chennai should be sent to Rajasthan. So for Rajasthan, the nearest port, Gujarat, there is the nearest port. So from Chennai, the coastal line, it will go to the Gujarat. And then from Gujarat, it will take the land movement to Rajasthan. This has given considerable saving in the logistics cost for the automotive manufacturer. At the same time, the price reduction will happen in the car and it will benefit the end consumer also. Okay, so that's about the coastal goods. And there was one case law given in your book. So imported drawings, and so there was a certain manufacturer, for his product he has imported some drawings and designs in the paper form, and it has been couriered from outside India to within India. Okay, and he held that these are not goods. Okay, but all those drawings, till it is in a computer, it is not a good. But when it was put in a paper, it becomes movable and it having its marketable also, and hence it is a goods. So Supreme Court held in that case, the goods which are in the form of designs is form of goods, and it is liable to customs duty. So it will be, valuation will be done by the assessable officer, and based on the valuation, the customs duty has to be paid on the assessable value. So the next thing is about this import report. So we are coming to the import. Okay, these are all concepts and definitions which are not orderly arranged in your book, but I have tried to arrange it in an orderly way. Now the import section starts. Okay, so import report. Okay, so within 12 hours of goods reaching the customs station. So import report is nothing but a report which should be filed by the importer of the goods. Okay, so let us take an example. The goods are coming through the shipping line. So when the goods come through the ship line, whenever it reaches the customs station, okay, so that is the customs barrier as we discussed earlier. So after, as soon as it reaches, your clock starts ticking and you have 12 hours of time. So within 12 hours, you have to create the import report. Import general manifest, we call it as IGM in all our companies while you work. IGM is almost a word which you use on a daily basis. Okay, and now it is being filed in the electronic mode with the customs office. Okay, so prior to the arrival of the goods to the custom station, IGM has to be filed in the electronic way. Okay, or if you are not able to do before arrival, at least after the parcel arrives, within 24 hours you can do that. But this is a deviation from the process and this has to be given go ahead from the commissioner of customs. Okay, so this is IGM, import general manifest. This is usually for the air shipment and sea shipment, and we call it as import report if it is through the land. Okay, so next there is one more important, very important concept, that is how our sea or water body is classified after our Indian landmass. Okay, so our Indian border, the landmass that is finishing, and after that the sea starts. So on the right hand side you will be having the Bay of Bengal, on the left hand side you will be having the Arabian Sea, and on the south you will be having the Indian Ocean. Okay, so what are which is form part of India, which is the point where the liability of customs act, or where you touch the customs barrier. Okay, that is very important. Okay, so that's why we are studying about this, classifying the water. Okay, so India includes a territorial water, so we call it as territorial water up to 12 nautical miles. Also, know guys, some objective type question would have given answers in kilometers. So how to convert the nautical miles into kilometer is also given in your book. Okay, so 12 nautical miles. So if they want in kilometers, 12 multiplied by 1.852. So that much of kilometer right from the land where it is ending and from where the sea starts. Okay, so up to that much of kilometer or that much of nautical miles, it the waters are classified as territorial water. Okay, and you can see I have given in one more point, right from 12 nautical miles to 200 nautical miles, it is called as continental shelf. Okay, so it is called as continental shelf, and after 200 nautical miles it is called as high seas. Okay, and the one more important point is 12 nautical miles, till 12 nautical miles is called as territorial water, and from 12 to 200 it is called as continental shelf. So right from 0 to 200, the whole region, which is nothing but the territorial water plus continental shelf, is called as exclusive economic zone. Okay, so this is what is the what we have to understand. So we call something as domestic tariff area. So domestic tariff area is nothing but our own domestic country. Okay, which means whenever a goods touches this, which means it is imported, and whenever a good move out of this, which means it is exported. Okay, so what is domestic tariff area is nothing but all the landmass of our country plus the territorial water, which we discussed, till 12 nautical miles, plus continental shelf, which we discussed, till 200 nautical miles, minus in our country some areas are classified as special economic zone and export oriented unit. So these units will manufacture goods, and either they will completely completely export. So all these regions are considered as a foreign region only. Okay, they can, if from a special economic zone, if a good should come out, they have to pay the import duty, because SEZ area itself is considered like a foreign country, and 100% export oriented unit is also considered like a foreign country, and any goods which, if it should come to the domestic area, it has to pay the relevant import duty. Okay, so these areas I am subtracting from that, and remaining all the areas is considered as the domestic tariff area. Okay, so from domestic tariff area, if I am sending to SEZ, so right now I said that SEZ, the area is considered as a foreign place itself, but for domestic tariff area to SEZ, there won't be any export duty. But SEZ to domestic tariff area, there will be an import duty. Okay, so there is one more point that was given, that is imported spares. Okay, to rigs. Okay, for example, Reliance Industries, they are exploring oil rigs, and they are taking the oils out. Okay, so this imported spares to rigs and at exclusive economic zone. So at exclusive economic zone, which is nothing but the 200 nautical miles, imported spares will be moved here and there. Okay, so these are all imported. From the word imported, yes, customs duty is leviable, but the items of spares are received only at the exclusive economic zone, and it will be consumed in the exclusive economic zone itself. Okay, so customs duty shall be levied on this. Okay, so you have to have a mapping on your mind so that these things become a little bit easy.